In a first-of-its-kind study, Northwestern doctors have discovered neurologic symptoms in non-hospitalized patients who had COVID-19. It found 85% of the patients in the study experienced four or more neurological symptoms, the most common being brain fog. We are joined by Dr. Igor Koralnik, the chief of neuroinfectious diseases at Northwestern Medicine. Doctor, thank you for joining me again this morning. And I find this study so interesting because you specifically looked at COVID-19 patients who were never hospitalized but still had those long hauler symptoms. And I think people think those usually happen to people who had to be hospitalized. So explain to me, who were these patients and what constitutes long hauler symptoms?
Thank you for inviting me in your program again. It's a pleasure to be here. So we had the occasion to speak in the past about our initial study on hospitalized patients with COVID-19 who developed neurologic manifestation, 82% of them. But those are severely sick patients who have pneumonia in the hospital. Many of them are intubated. This is a completely different population of patients. And the term long hauler has been chosen by the patient themselves by analogy to those long haul drivers who carry very heavy load on their truck for a very long period of time. This population is younger than the hospitalized patient, 43 years old in average, compared to 55 years old for those who are hospitalized. Okay. And they only had a mild and transient respiratory syndrome of COVID-19, like sore throat, mild cough, a little bit of muscle pain, chills, fever that went away. Uh-huh. But thereafter, and sometime after an interval free of any symptom, develop those persistent and debilitating neurologic problems, including brain fog, headache, numbness and tingling,
okay,
disorder of taste, disorder of smell, muscle pain, dizziness, pain, blurred vision, and ringing the ear.
Okay, I'm gonna jump in because I wanna show some of the graphics that we have made up as a result of your study, with brain fog being 81%. Why I find this so interesting as we look at some of the other issues, symptoms, is you have pointed out these are younger patients. They didn't have severe illness, yet these were things that were persistent. Let's go to the next one as we show some of the things involved, including muscle pain, 55%, tinnitus, which is ringing in the ear, 29%. I mean, those are symptoms that you would not expect, or at least I guess we assumed you wouldn't expect. You're the doctor here, so you would know better, but from mild reactions to COVID-19. Am I right?
You are completely right. And this was also a surprise for us. Obviously, these are people who came to the NeuroCOVID clinic because of those symptoms, but they were coming from the entire United States in televisits. We saw people from more than 21 states for this study, including people who came in person from the state of Illinois.
Okay.
In addition to those neurologic symptoms, they also had some cardiac problem, respiratory problem, and GI problem, in addition to intense fatigue.
Okay, and that was the next thing I wanted to bring up, because here's a look at the non-neurologic symptoms. Fatigue was 85%. That's something I hear from a lot of people who have had it. Depression, anxiety, 47. Shortness of breath, that is 46. Chest pain, 37%. And you also talked about insomnia, heart issues, and gastrointestinal problems. So what have you learned from this research, and what should we take from this going forward?
I think the most important aspect of this research is to realize that 70% of people coming to the COVID clinic, NeuroCOVID clinic, are women. And of those, 16% of all the patients have pre-existing autoimmune disease, which is higher than what is expected in the normal U.S. population. It is consistent with the hypothesis that long COVID, or what is now called post-acute sequela of SARS-CoV-2 infection, mm-hmm, is not a persistent infection of the brain or the nerves, but rather a post-infectious autoimmune problem where the virus has basically confused the immune system in thinking that normal components of the brain are abnormal and need to be attacked. And we see that also in other disease, autoimmune disease like multiple sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, or lupus, where there's a predominance of women over men.
Well, I think it's important to have you on too, because early on there were people who were never diagnosed because testing was limited. So I think it's important for people to hear what has come as a result of this study, because they may have been experiencing these things and not been tested and now know that it wasn't all in their head. Dr. Koralnik, thank you again. Always a pleasure. Please come back and see us again as you learn more about this. We appreciate your time.
Thank you very much.